Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Survive Your Childhood Now That You're an Adult, A Path to Authenticity and Awakening by Ira Israel. Narrated by Ira Israel. Dedicated to Dr. Thomas Rhoda. It is better to be hated for what you are than loved for what you are not. André Gide.
Foreword. So many of our brightest teachers today speak of enlightenment, both personal and planetary, from the mountaintop of their own awakened state, benevolently enticing us toward the possibility of being deeply present in the eternal now, expanding into unconditional love for ourselves and others, and awakening to a blissful oneness with all of life. Yet as much as we may yearn for these experiences, for most of us, it's as if Fred Astaire were dancing in topcoat and tails, effortlessly gliding around the dance floor, and saying, with a big, toothy grin, "Just dance like this." While it might be hard to admit, for most of us, the Maya in which we live, otherwise known as the cluster of cultural norms, assumptions, and expectations we automatically pledge allegiance to at a very young age, as well as the goals that often accompany them, will not dissolve simply because we take up meditating for 20 minutes each morning, study to become a yoga teacher, or take a 3-week hike through the Himalayas. These covert and pervasive assumptions must be made visible, challenged, and consciously evolved with great intelligence and dogged devotion so that we might renew our mindset to discover deeper, more authentic, and more life-affirming truths by which to live. The cultural illusions that Ira Israel so elegantly unpacks in this deep-thinking dive into the heart of being human are nothing short of a revelation. Finally, we have a name for that which has been driving us to be so driven. We understand, perhaps for the very first time, the real reasons that record numbers of us are struggling with an insidious low-grade fever of depression and anxiety. Yet more importantly, we begin to glimpse ways to move beyond the sea of discontent that so many of us have been swimming in, to reclaim the joy of what it is to be fully alive, and to live with a deeper sense of relatedness to one another and to all of life. Over my many years of teaching, I have discovered that there are basically two ways in which we human beings grow. One is that we grow horizontally. This means that we grow within the system we are already steeped in. For example, if you believe yourself to live in a dog-eat-dog world, and you spend your days trying to increase your skills in the hopes of becoming the leader of the pack, then horizontal growth might be learning how to be a bigger, better barker, or learning to run faster so you can leave the other dogs in the dust. In other words, horizontal growth is about learning new skills and growing new capacities to master the current world you already inhabit. However, there is also such a thing as vertical growth, growth that challenges and even deconstructs our current worldview and awakens us to another perspective altogether. It might be the sudden awareness that if you begin cooperating rather than competing with the other dogs, you just might be able to increase the well-being and happiness of the entire tribe of canines. This kind of growth creates radical and lasting change for the better. It's the moment when Dorothy leaves her black and white world and suddenly finds herself immersed in a brilliantly colorful one, or when Helen Keller first comprehends wawa, water, in a gasp of illumination. For the very first time, all you thought you knew is no longer relevant, and you realize in an instant that life will never be the same again. Everything is now radically repositioned and up for review inside your new perspective. This unique and transformative book is a catalyst for vertical growth, inviting us to question long-held cultural assumptions about life and love that may no longer be relevant and that may even be doing us harm. It is a compelling conversation that promises to unleash greater levels of well-being, happiness, authenticity, and depth in all of our relationships. So, if Ira pulls the rug out from under your feet and obliges you to set aside your certainty in favor of what you don't even know that you don't yet know, fear not. His mission is clear. He is devoted to waking us from our collective confusion and setting us on a more wholesome pathway so that we can find our way home to our own true north and closer to the hearts of one another, helping us to grow up in more ways than one. Katherine Woodward Thomas, New York Times best-selling author of Calling In the One and Conscious Uncoupling.
Introduction. Every adult wants to live a version of what he or she imagines is the good life. However, our versions of the good life are not only culturally contingent, but typically also intense amalgams of reactions to the approval and disapproval that we received as children. Many people have default voices in their heads that tell them whatever they do is not good enough. This hedonic treadmill manifests as phrases such as, I'll be happy when I have a better home, job, relationship, salary, vacation, automobile. The origin of this voice is the wounded child inside of us subconsciously and retroactively seeking the acceptance, approval, and love of primary caregivers, parents, teachers, siblings, and so on, who withheld love, loved us conditionally, or treated us in ways we did not understand. As sentient beings, we primarily desire one thing above all: to be loved unconditionally. But we grew up in a highly competitive, scarcity-based society that provided us with tools to gain love conditionally. Because we are talented, good-looking, go to good schools, get good grades, write well, speak well, dress well, earn boatloads of money, take vacations in the most exclusive places, and so on. Children create false selves, facades, personas, in order to obtain the acceptance, approval, and love they crave. However, any acceptance, approval, or love that we received as adults based on those facades and not on our inner and usually somewhat messy, authentic selves ultimately causes resentment. Many people have become so closely identified with their facades that they no longer know who they are other than what it says on their business cards, resumes, Facebook or LinkedIn profiles, Instagram and Twitter accounts, or in Google searches. Some younger people even judge or score their lives daily by the quantity of social media followers they have. Over 20 million Americans take antidepressants every day. Consider the possibility that the problem Americans face is not some rogue gene for depression. Our definition of depression might be culturally contingent. Maybe what we are experiencing is really loneliness, or the inability to connect with and securely attach to fellow human beings thinly veiled as pathology. Or maybe it is an inner feeling of unlovableness that was inadvertently inculcated into us by our parents and school system continually prodding us to be more, better, different. Many people in my generation, through the iconography and symbolism of pop culture, songs, films, television programs, and books, were tacitly promised the American dream. If you do well in school, then you will land a great job, marry a wonderful person, have exceptional kids, live in a fabulous house, and be happy. Many of my peers accomplished the school, job, marriage, kids, house part of that equation and are still not happy. Actually, they feel betrayed, mostly because those school, job, marriage, kids, house formulas are deathly expensive and force them to work 80 hours a week just to maintain a particular lifestyle. How to Survive Your Childhood Now That You're an Adult, A Path to Authenticity and Awakening, provides explanations as well as practical tools to help you live the life you truly want and be happy. Chapters 1 through 6 explore our level of awareness about subconscious beliefs or assumptions so that we can get some insight into our way of being in the world. How we choose to present ourselves to others, our attachment styles, the ways we think about work, and the activities we use to blow off steam. The goal is to raise our level of awareness about things that may be automatic, review the matrices of assumptions that construct our realities, and choose to make the healthiest decisions possible. We need to be cognizant of how prejudices and fears built during our childhood may influence our adult decisions. To do this, we will examine the unwitting psychological ramifications of capitalism, science, and religion. I hope this book provides different ways of seeing some of the ideas and conventions that we as a culture consider to be normal. One of the wonderful things about the growing trend of mindfulness, Buddhism light as I call it, in our culture is that people learn to observe their thoughts without identifying with them. And once we take the first steps on the path to awakening, we often notice that many of the characteristics we developed in order to get our emotional and psychological needs met as children are now hindering us from getting the love we desire as adults. We all learned how to get admired, but do we know how to be loving, lovable, loved? The first chapter of this book deconstructs what we think of as authenticity, and the following chapters raise consciousness concerning the ways of being in the world that we created to get our emotional and psychological needs met as children the best we could. In this book, we examine the myriad factors that influence the thousands of thoughts we experience every day. In particular, I argue that the dynamics of our early relationships with our primary caregivers, our society's myth regarding romance and romantic love, and the hyper-competitiveness of our version of capitalism have profound effects on the way we think, feel, and interact with others. Chapters 7 through 11 will lead you toward a reconstruction and give you tools to create a fresh perspective on who you are and what type of life you want to create, so that you can live as authentically and as awake as possible. Specifically, I advocate creating a new definition of authenticity, one that encapsulates attachment, atonement, attunement, presence, and congruence. In my study of consciousness during the past 30 years, I have aggregated an array of tools for alleviating suffering and keeping people at the higher end of their happiness spectrums. The number one thing that correlates with happiness is how we connect with and attach to other people. Human beings are interdependent creatures. We do not grow or evolve in bubbles. We want and need our connections to other people to be secure, trustworthy, positive, supportive, loving, and healthy. But we live in a culture that inadvertently foments separation and alienation, namely by putting us in constant competition with other people as workers, money earners, and consumers. And so we lead unbalanced lives, sometimes double lives, and fall prey to afflictions and addictions. The only solution is authenticity, which is difficult but must be attempted and practiced daily. As the saying goes, we must be the change we want to see in the world. It is up to us to break the chains of unskillful solutions that were handed down to us, such as constructing glitzy and cool facades. We must consciously decide who we want to be, what type of relationships will nourish us, and what type of world we want to live in. Making commitments to healthy practices such as meditation and yoga and being congruent, having our outer lives match our inner lives, will keep us at the higher ends of our happiness spectrums. In this book, we explore how to surf the apparent paradoxes of life, learn how to be present, learn how to embrace every moment of our lives, discover how to shed fears and prejudices, learn how to have discipline, recognize our attachment styles and learn how to improve them, discern what activities we use to blow off steam and stop them from becoming afflictions or addictions, learn how to attune to other people so that we can securely connect with them, learn how to be okay with the fact that our futures are uncertain and that when they occur, they will certainly contain both joys and sorrows. Chapter 1. What does it mean to be authentic? When someone tells me that he wishes to be authentic with me, my body tenses up as if it were about to be stabbed. Usually what the person means is that he wants to be brutally honest with me. Emphasis on brutally. He imagines that what he wants to say is going to offend me, and he thinks that I will be more receptive and that it will somehow soften the blow if he claims that his comment falls under the pretense of being authentic. This perception is inaccurate. Most people wouldn't know authenticity if it bit them on the leg. What then is authenticity? Colloquially, being authentic usually describes someone sincerely speaking his deep inner thoughts, a supposed honest monologue, one that is often critical about something emotionally stinging, or at least sensitive, and marginally beyond the scope of what we consider to be normal, acceptable, or polite everyday conversation. You wouldn't say to someone, "I want to be authentic with you. I think it's going to rain." Most people say things such as, "I need to be authentic with you. This relationship isn't working out for me anymore." Or, "Boss, I don't feel that business is my true calling. It doesn't feel authentic to me anymore. I quit this job to become a yoga teacher." In general, it seems as if being authentic frequently relates to saying something negative to someone else in an attempt to modify his or her behavior in some way. And modifying someone else's behavior does include making that person disappear from one's life. It appears that it is difficult to say something authentically positive about someone else. I authentically love you. Doesn't sound quite right, does it? I authentically believe that your new hairstyle is a wonderful decision. Seems to betray some doubt. One assumption, often made about authenticity, is that we can be authentic only when decrying our own inauthenticity. This means that an authentic statement can neither be about someone else nor be positive. For example, I was lacking in integrity when I did not return your urgent phone call. I'm really sorry. Or, I acted passive-aggressively when we were at dinner the other night. Please forgive me. I am not sure that we can only be authentic when decrying our own inauthenticity, but it is a provocative understanding of authenticity. Try to imagine other ways that we think of authenticity when we hear people use that word. Many times, it has to do with vocations and people being trapped in golden handcuffs or life situations that they did not foresee. For example, what I really want to do is paint, but I have two kids in college and painting will not pay the bills. Or, I love teaching yoga, but if I quit my corporate job, I won't be able to afford the mortgage on my new house. Vocations are extremely important, and I address them in chapters 5, 7, and 8. For now, let's focus on what we mean when we talk about speaking authentically. The first thing we need to consider is language. How does language function? How does language relate to thoughts? How do thoughts relate to consciousness? What thoughts are unconscious? Do thoughts exist only in the form of words? How do thoughts relate to emotions? What are people doing when they speak? Most of the time, we are thinking in particular languages. The majority of my thoughts are in English. Is it possible to have thoughts in our minds that are not in a language? Is it possible to think outside of a language? Of course, music, painting, sculpture, dancing, and all other art forms, and even making love, are languages. But when we are hungry, we do not normally imagine a sensual Rodin sculpture. We think, I should get something to eat. And then we go eat something. Thinking exists within a matrix of culturally accepted assumptions, norms, and mores. Feeling exists within a matrix of culturally accepted assumptions, norms, and mores. Language exists within a matrix of culturally accepted assumptions, norms, and mores. And writing exists within a matrix of culturally accepted assumptions, norms, and mores. All disciplines, too, such as art, music, politics, economics, and psychology, among others, exist within matrices. Babso dax laguna dondo, gibberish, lies outside of those agreed-upon assumptions. I feel dead, when not taken as hyperbole, meaning numb, lies outside agreed-upon assumptions about feeling, since dead people, to the best of our knowledge, cannot feel. The statement, I'm going to eat the neighbor's puppy for supper, lies outside our agreed-upon mores. Breathing air is profitable, does not make much sense either. The fact that a group of people more or less consistently agree on words meaning or referring to the same or similar concepts and things constructs what I consider to be a paradigm. Our society, Western civilization, lies on a bed of agreements buttressed by beliefs that fall under the general categories that we refer to as science, capitalism, and religion. From our faith in science, capitalism, and religion, we derive our paradigm of order. Rules and laws dictate and maintain order in our society. People who disrupt social order are imprisoned or dispatched. Some of the central assumptions of Western civilization are property ownership, marriage for life, money, voting, 3 meals a day, sex for non-procreational purposes, inheritances, war, business, banking, debt, fossil fuels, electricity, mass transportation, media, and more recently, mobile telephones, smartphones, the internet, social media, and virtual reality. Given that the mandate of science is truth, which really is a search for an accurate mapping of what's out there, not in our heads, This leads to a brief but important distinction about truth and subjective-objective duality. Philosopher Immanuel Kant proposed that objective truth was out there, and that we could never know it from our subjective points of view. I do not believe that truth exists out there in the world. I believe that people within any paradigm form a consensus regarding what truth currently is. They agree on certain concepts, but upon inspection, many of these concepts can be deconstructed. For example, I could say, well, we all agree that murder is bad, to which you could retort, what about in war or capital punishment? Are those not murders? Philosophers have rhetorically asked, when someone says the word red and another person hears the word red, how can we be certain that they have mental images of the same color? That does not render the concept of red useless. Watch out for the rapidly approaching red truck is a useful phrase. But certainty on what constitutes red is difficult to achieve, if not impossible. When it is contingent upon language working in conjunction with optical nerves and neurons firing and wiring in our brains. Or definitions may be simply tautological, as in, red is red and it is obvious to everyone, save the colorblind. The following metaphor is useful regarding the subjective-objective distinction. The map is not the territory. Every person has a map in his or her head that maps the reality out there. However, some people are colorblind, some are tone deaf, some are myopic. Some have wonderful olfactory ranges and taste subtle flavors, and other people do not. In a graduate class in philosophy I attended in 1989, to argue a position, visiting professor Eddie Zemach asked another professor what it was like when that professor's wife experienced an orgasm. I bet you thought that philosophy couldn't be so much fun. The professor went into an elaborate and somewhat romantic description of blood surging up from his wife's feet and legs, heat rising and sweat beating, intensification of breathing, moaning, and so on. When he was finished, Professor Zemach disabused him of the notion of being able to know what it was like when his wife had an orgasm. That's what happens when you have an orgasm. You have no idea what it is like for your wife to experience an orgasm. The best you can do is project onto her your experience when you have an orgasm. I cannot see the world from another person's point of view. I can only see it from my own. The map is not the territory. Or as Magritte demonstrated in his painting, Ceci n'est pas une pipe, a painting of a pipe is not a pipe. One cannot smoke a painting, nor can one smoke a word. Language points to phenomena. Language indicates. As we will find out in my discussions on psychology, it is important to recognize that although we seem to agree on language, every person has a subjective point of view that is based on his or her experiences and the language he or she uses to think about and express those experiences. But first, let's examine how thinking, feeling, and communicating relate to each other. Our cultural paradigm recognizes something we call consciousness, that is a function of our minds. Although we use the terms consciousness and mind frequently, if you really think about them, they are difficult to define. For example, if I ask you to touch your consciousness or point to your mind, you would probably be flummoxed or at least uncertain. Both consciousness and mind are non-local. Neither can be reduced to a particular place. Yes, some people point to their heads when asked where their minds reside. Others, such as Tibetans, point to their hearts. My point is that many people conflate mind and brain and are quickly to speak about neuroplasticity and creating neural pathways, about sensing in some way their prefrontal cortices and corpus callosums and getting their right hemispheres to interact with their left hemispheres. But it is actually difficult to precisely relate the concepts of mind and brain. And by difficult, I mean impossible. In fact, I prefer to hear a Christian scientist refuse to go to the hospital for a broken arm because he's convinced that Jesus Christ will heal it than hear a meditation teacher discuss enlarging his corpus callosum. What I'm asking you to question is the way that the scientific paradigm has been appropriated by lay people who really do not understand what has and has not been scientifically proven. Science has made exponential progress over the last few centuries but still does not know how a human brain functions any more than it can explain how gravity causes the tides to move in and out. There are theories, there are correlations. Correlations have been observed and noted. But the goal of science is to ascribe causality, not correlation. No scientist worth her salt will say, I have located and isolated the gene that causes people to be homosexual. Or, I have mapped particular neurological firings consistent in all human beings that occur when they decide to vote Republican. Try on this metaphor, please. The brain is the hardware and the mind is the software. Although it is in vogue to discuss neuroplasticity and neural pathways, the next time a meditation teacher tells you that you will create new neural pathways when you meditate, please ask him to show you which neural pathways are created. A brain can be discussed only with the aid of an MRI machine. Most people do not have these $1.5 to $3 million machines constantly at their disposal. So it is easier to reach an agreement about a Jackson Pollock painting than about the electricity bouncing around inside a human head. Human beings do not have direct introspection into brain states. At no time in your lifetime will you hear someone say, synapses 85932 and 700774 just fired. I need to take an aspirin. Or, I just created a new neural pathway for a color between orange, brown, and green. You will never hear someone say, I can feel the dopamine rushing through my brain. You will hear, I'm happy. You will never hear someone say, my serotonin levels are very high. You will hear, I feel good. We must continue to use the concept of mind to mediate between what we sense and feel and how those stimuli are processed through our brain states and then translated into language. We cannot directly see into or otherwise sense our brain states or any other parts beneath our skin, so it is inaccurate to talk as if we do. When I speak with neurologists, they tell me that they are baffled by the ignorance of lay people who feel qualified to discuss neuroplasticity and how our brains create neural pathways. Of course the brain creates new neural pathways. So what? We will never directly observe our brains creating neural pathways, so why is it popular to use these terms today? Lay people prefer to have an inaccurate accord about brains than to speak with precision about consciousness. In the 1960s, Thomas Kuhn wrote that scientific paradigms shift every generation, or approximately every 25 years. He obviously didn't anticipate a behemoth such as the internet that would cause paradigm shifts in time periods much shorter than a single generation. Science is a system, and that system is dynamic. If we tried to explain to our grandmothers in 1975 that someday cancer would be manageable, gay people could marry, a black man would be president of the United States, or marijuana would be legal, they would have looked at us askew. The same way you would look at me if I told you that someday marijuana would be mandatory, all religions would be illegal, America would be ruled by a dictator, and the only edible meat left on earth would be from rats. We are all fish swimming in a cultural sea of language and norms and mores that we cannot see, that we consider to be normal. If in 1950 you had told an American to eat raw fish, he would have laughed in your face, maybe called you a commie pinko. Today, there is a sushi restaurant on every other corner. Normal changes faster than we imagine. When
exploring, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.